I actually wasn't aware that Gotosan was going to be talking about some of the transforms. So, but fortunately, this has kind of worked out quite well because I think our two presentations are dovetailing quite nicely. I'm going to talk about some of the detail of two or three of the, two mainly of the transforms that resulted from the feedback from software developers in the UK. So this should hopefully work out pretty well. Okay, so I think you all know that, probably picked up most of that from the previous presentation. Inline XBRL is now a recommendation. And the rendering working group's attention has now turned to the rendering link-based work, and the transformation rules are the only thing that's still hanging over work-wise for Inline XBRL. I think I'm right in saying that that the TR is at candidate rec stage at the moment. Is that correct, Philip? And should be a last call for that fairly soon and rec pretty quickly. And we probably ought to point out that the current transformation rules registry is part of the spec and therefore has to be supported by conformal processes. The new transformation registry is in effect an optional extra that conforming processes can support if they wish, and obviously has a different namespace. So I'll dive down in some detail of a couple of the transforms that Gotosan had in his table. These were based on some early feedback from implemented in the UK from some of our software developers who were experiencing some issues with marking up existing documents. So we're not talking here about necessarily about generating inline XBRL from applications. We're talking about conversion applications that are allowing users to take existing documents that have been produced by some kind of manual process as Word or Excel or even PDF documents and converting them to inline XBRL, which is something which a lot of companies in the UK are doing, at least as a stopgap until they get their acts together on better internal processes for generating their inline XBRL documents for tax filing. The new transforms, as we saw in the table, there are some improved and extended date and monetary formats, and we're still working on some of the monetary formats. There are some additional Japanese monetary formats in the new transformation registry. But there was also two, at the top of the table there, you saw two transforms for Boolean values and one called no content for empty fixed items. And I'm going to try and attempt to explain the kind of use case for both of these types of transform. So we'll look at Boolean first. The issue here is that there are a number of items a number of concepts in the UK accounts taxonomies. I'm sure this is not unusual, where the value, expected value, is a Boolean. But typically, you don't see accountants writing statements like it's true that the company is trading. There is a word true there you could mark up if you wanted to, but you don't usually get the luxury of doing that. So the issue for software developers or for manual taggers using manual tagging tools is that there is nothing on the face of the document to tag to give you the value that you ends up with in the XBRL target instance. So for instance, in the UK accounts taxonomy's common business module, we have a Boolean type called entity trading, obvious concept. And on the face of a document, you might see a statement like that. I'm probably shortened what the legalese is, but that's basically what you'll see on the face of a document. And what we actually want is to transform that to the value true in the instance document. So we have to find some way of getting from one to the other. The way that software developers and users of conversion tools have approached this issue at the moment is that they have simply avoided marking up this information on the face of the document and have embedded the marked up item, the true for entity trading, in the hidden section of an inline XBRL document. Hopefully most of you understand that that is possible to provide some hidden data that doesn't normally appear on the face of the account. And they've been using that to mark these things up. Now that's fine, it means that the value of that that fact gets into the instance document, but there is no correspondence between what a human being sees on the face of the document and that value. So there is an assurance issue about, you know, examining the document and trying to make sure that the human rendering and the computer readable part actually correspond. And if there's no link between those two things, it's difficult. There's more work to do to assure yourself that that correspondence is correct. So the phrase the company trading may appear somewhere on the face of the document, and that Boolean setting of true appears in the hidden section, but there's actually no relationship between them unless you understand the link between the concept name and that statement on the face of the document. So this transform, or the two Boolean transforms, are an attempt to try and link the two, the markup on the face of the document with the target data. So I don't know whether you can all read that, but that's a fragment of inline XBRL for that statement the company is trading. Okay, so that it's a non-numeric marked up with the name of the entity, name of the concept, a context reference we don't need to worry about, and the format transform in this case is IXT colon Boolean true, which is one of the new transforms. And that very simply allows you to transform in the target document to that fact set to true. The format transform is the sort of thing that in a conversion conversion tool, the end user will see as a pop-up list of transforms. So someone's working through a document, marking up, and they come to that statement. They're likely, when they try to mark something up, the tool that they're using is going to say, well, what format transform do you want to apply to this? So it's going to be very easy to say, right, okay, I know that's a Boolean statement, really, so I'm just going to apply the appropriate transform, whether it be true or false, to that statement. And I've now made the link between the information on the face and the target document. And any tool that highlights the markup on the face of the document and associates that with the data will preserve that link, obviously, because the link is there through the transform. Okay, so that's the kind of easy one to explain. The no content one is actually slightly harder to explain. I need to just explain a little bit about how the UK accounts taxonomies work. So in this particular case, we have a concept called director signing report. Now, it doesn't actually take a value, this concept. It is of type fixed item type, and it's expected to be empty, expected to be null. The purpose of this this item is to associate the fact that a director has signed the report with the appropriate dimension member that represents that director in the entity officer's dimension. So this is really acting as a flag to say director one or director two or whoever, and there's a name associated with that director, is a director who has signed the report, and it's simply acting as a flag. The beauty of this sort of idea is that you can actually flag multiple directors, so you don't have to do anything clever to deal with a case where two directors sign the report or three directors sign the report. However many directors the company has, each one could potentially have this flag set against them, and it's explicitly doesn't require any value. So in this particular case, again, I've kind of shortened the legalese, but essentially that's what you'd see on the face of a set of accounts. This document has been signed, the director's report has been signed by a particular director whose name appears in that statement. And what we actually want to transform that to is an empty dimensioned item that is associated with that director. So somewhere else in the document there will already be a concept that links the name of the director to the appropriate dimension member, which is dealt with through this context. So imagine that context uses the entity officer's dimension to set Director 1 as the domain member for that dimension. We've now associated thread blocks with that. So that appears somewhere else in the document. The point of the transform, this is the inline XBRL that contains the transform, is to associate the name Fred Blogs in that statement there with this same dimension member. Okay, so on the face of the document, you'll be marking up that name, but actually there will be no content in the target item. You are simply associating the name Fred Blogs on the face of the account with the fact that that's the director who has signed the account and his name has been captured elsewhere by conventionally marking up the director's name through name entity officer. And that obviously transforms to a director signing report, which is empty. So does everyone follow that? Because it does require a little bit of understanding. No, Roland, go on.
I don't know.
You don't know?
No, I can't see why you would assign the name Fred Blogs to an empty dimensioned item.
Right.
I mean, you want to attach it to a combination of the dimension and the domain.
Yeah, elsewhere in the document. So this statement here will appear at the bottom of the director report, okay? Elsewhere in the document, there'll be a list of the directors of the company. Okay, and in that list, you'll have marked up the names. And that's why I've put this in brackets, because somewhere else in the document you already have an association between the name Fred Blogs and a member in the entity officer's dimension. Okay?
Okay, so you have a multiple reference needed.
In effect, yes. So where in this statement you've got the name Fred Blogs, I can't tag Fred Blogs directly as the value of director signing report, because director signing report is a fixed item of zero length. It is there simply to flag the association with the member in the dimension. Okay? Do you follow?
Yeah.
Okay? So at the moment, there is no way to associate that flag item with that name there. But with this transform, on the face of the document, that name will be highlighted and it will be associated via the transform with that in the target document, which is the association you want to preserve. Yeah. It's a peculiarity of the way the UK accounts taxonomies have been designed, but it's a very sort of flexible and powerful way of kind of providing a way of flagging informational flags against particular values in a dimension. Okay. Cool. So actually, that was all I wanted to say, and that's just about my time. So other than Roland's questions, is there anyone else? Anyone else got any questions?
They don't dare to.
Okay. Thank you very much. It'll be 1 second while we transfer a.
So we want to switch over slightly to talking about inline XBRL and its introduction into the Global Filing Manual. So I'm Andromeda Wood. I work for Ernst & Young, but at the moment I'm on secondment to the IFRS Foundation, who are one of the parties involved in the Global Filing Manual. The Global Filing Manual itself is compiled and managed by a group called the ITA, the Interoperable Taxonomy Architecture Project, which is a It is a collection of basically suggested and recommended rules that have been used in other regulatory projects for XBRL filing to regulators. So they are aimed at regulators around the world who are thinking of putting together their own project and would like to look at what other projects have done and ways that they have regulated their systems and the XBRL coming in and out. Up till now, of course, it hasn't had any inline XBRL in it because there haven't been any projects. So what's been done recently is to add inline XBRL rules to this document, mostly based on work that the HMRC has done for its recent filing project. Reasons to add inline XBRL are, of course, that not only is it a new standard that's now in recommendation, but it's in use in one regulatory project, and I know that other countries are considering using it for their projects, and also that not all of the features of inline XBRL are covered by existing rules in the GFM, although obviously some are, as they're quite generic in some cases. So the GFM itself is split into two main sections, where rules are classified either by what is called either syntax or semantics. This does occasionally cause some problems, but the basic difference is that the rules in the syntax section are to do with the actual XBRL syntax of file documents. And in theory, most of them are something that can be automated in a validation service in some way, or in some software. The semantics section are more to do with the semantics of file documents, how they appear and that kind of thing. And many of these are not so automatable. The rule doesn't always apply, but in general, that's how the document is divided. The new inline XBRL rules can be found in sections 1.10 and sections 2.9. Obviously, this won't mean much to you now, but if you download the document and look later, that might help you find it a little bit more easily. Many of the new rules are from the HMRC documentation. All the rules in the GFM are attributed, so if you look at the bottom, you can see where in which document these rules come from and in which systems. Obviously, some of the existing XBRL rules in that document from other filing systems like the SEC and Japan EDINET may still apply to an inline system. As I said, some of them are quite generic and some of them just apply to which data you should report, how you should report it, that kind of thing. And also in this particular release, there were other changes made to other rules in GFM as a result of changes made to other systems or suggestions made or feedback given. And if you're interested in those, then there should be full details of those in the change history. And if you want more detail, it is possible to request a change control version from the IFRS Foundation if you really want to see the detail of what's changed. So I've got a series of just some very quick example additions to go through so you can see the kind of thing that's been put into the document. So this first one is a basic restriction on what kind of HTML you can use when submitting your inline XBRL document. So this is a rule that's been suggested, sort of thinking, so it's from one of HMRC's rules, and in general it's thinking in the way a regulator might think, what can we do to try and restrict the work we've got to do in our system, what can we do to make files validatable? So in this case, well, let's restrict it to XHTML. We can parse XHTML within the inline specification. We have the modular schemas available to enable us to properly validate it this way. It seems to make a certain amount of sense to improve the system. It's easier to process, it's generally less permissive, there's not as much formatting and mucking about you can do with XHTML as you can do with HTML. So hopefully it should allow things to be a bit more processable and usable. This corresponds to a rule from the XBRL style guide for HMRC, which is actually rule 3.3, that was detailed in the GFM. And in this case, the GFM also provides you at the back with an index to all the rules, but also a couple of columns which indicate to you whether the writers have thought that this rule is probably automatable, and also whether or not they would recommend that when considering it, a regulator might want to go, well, actually, I think I should tailor this rule. This probably isn't going to suit all regulator systems. So there's also been a sort of a suggestion put there for people to bear in mind. Another example addition made for inline XBRL is that they must not contain executable code either in the HTML script element or elsewhere in the file. It should be reasonably obvious what the intention behind that rule. Again, this is from the HMRC's guidelines. It's for security reasons. It's to try and help prevent the submission of dangerous code into regulated systems, although obviously those systems would hopefully have been designed to cope in those situations anyway. Obviously, this is only partially possible to check in an automated fashion because there are many, many possible ways people could try and insert code into a web page. But it's strongly recommended. It hasn't been listed as something that people may want to consider to tailor because it's quite an important security recommendation. Another rule that's been looked at, now this is a sort of a different kind of addition. This isn't one from the HMRC systems. This has been added into the inline section of the document because it corresponds to rules on any non-inline sections of the document. So there are many rules in that section where they give quite a certain amount of detail on how the syntax of XBRL features, in this case footnotes. So there are various rules that have been added to the inline section to correspond to those rules to update the syntax required so that it matches the requirements for inline XBRL, where obviously sometimes there are syntactical differences. So in the case of footnotes, they are much less complicated when they're in an inline document. They don't have the arcs and so on present. So these are in the inline section so that the whole document is consistent. The rules can be applied. You don't have to try and work your way back from a rule intended for real XBRL, this main XBRL standard to what you want to do with the inline XBRL. We then have a few rules, there's two in particular, which are to do with use of the hidden sections. In many ways, the hidden sections in an inline XBRL document are very useful, but there are a couple of reasonably obvious things that could be done with them that are not necessarily so good from a regulatory point of view. For example, hiding different values for items or values that are submitted to the system in the hope that the user who is looking at the document and reviewing it can't see them. Obviously, this could be used in a very misleading fashion. So there are a couple of rules, one here which explicitly mentions the IX hidden section, and another rule which it talks more about ways you can use HTML and CSS to hide data, which suggests that these are not allowed in a regulatory system. These are both much harder to validate, especially the one about using HTML and CSS, because, for example, it is quite hard to check that somebody has not used a text color, which will be invisible against the background color. It's possible to have a look, but you can't validate against all those situations, or at least I believe not anyway. We will have, coming soon to go with the whole GFM, not just the inline section, a conformance suite, which hopefully will make any ambiguity in any of the rules a bit clearer and will provide software developers who are looking to develop software that at least validates against some of the conformance suite rules with some test cases to work to. The work on this is currently in progress. I say coming soon, but at the moment there isn't a specific release deadline for this. If you've got any questions or suggestions for test cases, if you're already familiar with the rest of the GFM, then feedback would in general be quite useful. I've included some useful links. I'll put them up here if you want to make a quick scribbled note of them. If not, come and grab them off me, or of course the presentation will be with her later, be uploaded to be available with the rest of the conference presentations. So that's basically all I have to do. It's a very quick run through of the kind of thing that's been introduced. If you've got any questions, I'm happy to try and answer some now. There's also an email address for GFM questions in general, which is then, as you can see it on here, it's gfm@ifrs.org. And those questions are then passed on to the ITA, who obviously will then try and do their best to answer these questions. So has anybody got any questions for me now? Yes?
I'm sorry, nobody wants to ask questions here.
We have you.
I'm a little confused, maybe a little outside the inline XBRL, but HMRC is text. And I know text as being a closed environment, not allowing tell what you ever want to tell us, but more form-based, you tell us these things, and we don't want to know all the other things. GFM is about extensions. Rule 11.6, and I read from the content, a filing must contain at least one filer extension schema, which means extensions must be added. For Dutch text, it's definitely a no-no. HMRC will comply to that, say extensions is good?
I believe what HMRC at the moment discourages extensions, but they are possible. And from a slightly more global filing manual point of view, as I said, it's to a certain extent, these things are phrased as rules and do say must, and they are taken from existing filing systems and environments. But that doesn't mean that a regulator can't look at a rule and go, actually, for me, that really is not suitable for my environment. it's not necessarily intended that the document is taken as a whole and applied without reading through it and without thinking about these things.
Okay.
Hence the tailorability column.
Okay, so you say that HMRC people have to comply with GFM except for, and then you have a list of rules that
it's
don't
that
apply.
Kind of thing. It's intended to give a proper good list of ways that regulatory systems work. At the moment, because it is heavily based on certain regulatory systems, because it's put together by the ITA, feedback is generally useful. So as the document becomes more generic, is looked at by more people and more regulatory systems, I'm sure that that kind of comment will be taken on board by the ITA. And you know, if you want to send that into the email address, they'll look at it. Obviously, I'm standing here at the moment, so I can't guarantee that anything will actually happen, but you know.
Well, knowing the Americans, it won't happen.
But no, there have been several comments in already from reviewing the GFM previously when it was released a few weeks ago. And they've already gone to the ITA, so there were more comments in is always welcome. Any other questions? Okay.
Thank you very much.